down to the life is from Lovely Rockets. And hopefully when I come to my body. Who's got the timer?
I have a big stick.
Sounds good. A clash of wrist cymbals made us all turn toward the door of the grand ballroom. I, Prince Erval, waited within the sacred globe of life for the arrival of my brother, Prince Nigel, and his bride to be, beautiful Indira, whom we'd all known for 2 years and loved since we first met. I, especially, alas. Negotiation between our two ancient houses to agree to terms was cursory. No one would stand in the way of a genuine love match. Ah, would that I had been so fortunate, but once she met H.L., she never looked at me again. There had been so many other advantages to the marriage. I could not object, and my soul cried out to her every time we met. I did my best to keep my jealousy subdued. It would show in the color of my skin. I was truly happy for H.L. If I could not have Indira, then he was the only other choice in the galaxy I would make for her. I kept myself as green as possible to show happiness as the ceremony commenced. A Terran dancer led the wedding procession into the room. Around and behind her floated an envelope of dark carmine red, a color of celebration on the world, the fabric cut to simulate the wide, soft wings of flesh of our bodies, the pale golden skin of her face, hands and feet, and long, deep, flowing brown hair seemed to contrast oddly. All things about humans were odd. Their manipulative digits lay at the end of bony arms that looked too exposed without the spans of our wings, whereas we had sensors and digits at wingtip and on the front of our bodies, concealed in a nest of silky blue hair 10 to 12 centimeters long. Unlike us, their faces were on round, bony heads at the tops of their brains instead of a third of the way down, where it could be enfolded protectively in our sails in case of a threat. That was the primitive reaction, naturally. We'd had bread and protective devices for centuries. And Terran's feet faced the wrong way, their ankles at the back instead of at the front. I wonder how she kept them falling over. The dancer circled the chamber again and again, clicking her wrist instruments in a hypnotic rhythm. Indira's honor attendants, both male and female, swept in behind and took their places around the globe. In spite of the gravity, which was heavier on so tile, they moved with grace. They were happy. Their skins glowed brilliant emerald, turquoise, and teal. I chose contingents, greatly outnumbered them, followed, emitting slightly more somber hues. In their wake came I chose. His face was solemn, but his brown eyes were wide with astonished pleasure. I had never seen him so happy. He took his place beside me and bumped me with his left wing. I bumped back. In spite of the envy I felt, I loved him and wished him well. Our eyes fixed upon the door. As if weightless, Indira floated into the room. The soft barbels on top of her wings flew backwards like streamers. She had dusted her skin with powdered crystalline gold. When she passed through the walls of the sphere of light, the whorls of curlicues glittered. She was dazzling. Aichel let out a breath that deflated his body and moved to stand at her side. Our mother, Queen Genoa, spread out her wings in greeting and began the traditional ceremony of marriage. Outside, two quarter arms of the translucent walls of the enormous chamber, beings of several species stood gazing in. They were not invited, but as they were passengers on board the sinister system liner, they were curious about our joining ceremony, which had taken up most of the time and attention of the event planner and his staff for over a month, turned around. One dyke had asked permission to allow them to watch in the name of interstellar cooperation. We were as curious about many of these races as they were about us, so I challenged him in his word. It was the first Royal Sartian Senate ceremony to take place on the planet. In a cultural exchange that would benefit our system as well, visuals of the event would be beamed to many worlds. We were here because Indira had expressed a wish for what the Terrans called a destination wedding. I told and I did nothing. Besides, it sounded like fun. The gravity was higher aboard the Terran's life luxury liner, but beyond that, we lacked no comfort. Even though the trip would be 3 months long, a significant portion of our lifespans, it was worth it to secure the marriage. Indira's family tended to live almost 5 years longer than my family spanned 30 or so years. It was not only her beauty and charm that made her attractive to our very choosy parents. The interchange of cells between her and Eichel would add vigor to their descendants, increasing the length of the lives of the royal line, including Eichel himself, while correspondingly shortening her own. So Titans breathe easily and freely among ourselves.
Can I read the last line?
Now came the moment of life sharing. Eichel and Indira opened their wings forward and pressed together, face to face, along every centimeter of their bodies. I heard Eichel's deep baritone voice murmur within the folds of flesh. What a bride and groom said to one another within that intimate embrace, I did not yet know. We life share only once. During that moment, a chemical exchange occurs that averages out our immune and endocrine systems. Barring accident or illness, means that each of them has now lived exactly the same length of time as the other, so neither would be left alone in this world after we depart. Soon, in yours, turquoise skin and I shall see that my green shifted into the totally precisely the same shade of aqua. They have become more fun.